Hey, you guys, welcome, welcome back. How is everyone doing today? Oh my gosh, you guys, you already know. I always tell you guys that we have a great topic and a great episode today, but I really, really mean it. I mean it all the other times, but I definitely mean it today. So as you guys know, we have been hosting a series of conversations for the month of June in terms of relationship and how does relationship looks as we show up in our business, in our careers, in our lifestyle, in our personal relationship with others. So as we conclude the relationship series, I have a juicy, amazing guest that's going to conclude our relationship series. And this relationship has to do with ourselves, right? Self-love. How do we show up for ourselves? So I'm so honored. I'm so excited, you guys. Oh my gosh, we had to do so much coordination to bring this episode to fruition. but I'm so happy she was able to oblige and we were able to have this conversation. So again, welcome to Chop It Up. Y'all already know who it is. And we are so happy that this is episode 17, you guys. Episode 17. Let's go right into it. I'm going to read you her bio because she's amazing. She's a firecracker. And I really want this conversation to be organic and you guys can benefit more from it. So this episode, we really want to focus on mental wellness. As you guys know, June is a month for mental wellness. So as we conclude the month, what better way to bring it home with a mental wellness expert? So let's go. KJ, how do you pronounce your last name? Landers.
Yeah, you got it right.
I love it. KJ Landers, as a mental health advocate and a mediator for over 10 years, Kaneta KJ Landers has dedicated her life to bringing mental health awareness into underserved communities like one she grew up in. She believes meditation, as well as various forms of breath work, can be a powerful tool for addressing mental health issues. KJ uses her social media platform to teach meditation as well as other techniques beneficial in addressing stress, anxiety, panic, depression, and so much more. In her hope that through the use of yoga, specifically meditation and breath work, that she will fulfill her purpose of teaching others how to properly address their mental health issues. Join KJ Landers every Monday on Clubhouse at 8 p.m. Eastern, where she shares meditation as well as life and relationship advice. And of course, you can follow her on Instagram, KJ Landers. KJ, welcome to Chop It Up. How are you?
Thank you. I'm good. Thank you for having me. I'm excited.
I am so excited that you've obliged. Thank you and welcome to the family. Welcome to Chop It Up. This is a home of unfiltered, unapologetic conversation. So you ready?
I'm ready.
Let's go. Well, KJ, as I said, this month you are our final guest as we wrap up the June relationship series. And I really wanted us to talk about, you know, and just be organic, mental health. As we know, in relation to COVID-19, it really has affected so many of us, even my mental health. Like, KJ, I don't know about you, but like, I was going through it the first 3 months of the quarantine. I was like, matter of fact, I'm lying. The first month, it was cool. I think everyone was like, oh yes, we're going to have an extended vacation. It's going to be good. But after while we are in it and the 3 months, I was suffering from isolation and I really wanted to connect with others. And I know I'm not the only one. Right. So on the heels of, as we come out of, you know, the pandemic and, you know, what can you share? What has been your mental, you know, wellness journey? And what can you share with our listeners about how to take care of our mental health?
Definitely. So I am a person who has battled with mental health issues probably for majority of my life. In my early 20s, I suffered I suffered a lot from really debilitating anxiety and panic. So I didn't understand, you know, how to cope with it. I hadn't learned any coping skills. I really hadn't learned how to deal with that. I was on medications. I was trying to figure out how to, you know, just cope through my daily life with dealing with such debilitating anxiety and panic. And it wasn't until probably about my late 20s, about 27, 28 years old, I really started dedicating a lot of my time to learning how to cope with a lot of my anxiety and panic. I started to see a therapist, and that was probably my first understanding of how impactful breath work can be. And all breath work is using techniques of the breath, dealing with the breath in order to cope with anxiety, panic. It can be really helpful for depression and just other mental health issues. So around 27, 28, I really started dedicating a lot of time to breath work and meditation, just learning how to breathe properly, learning how to do meditation in order to cope with a lot of the things that I was dealing with in terms of my panic and anxiety. Mm-hmm. And so moving forward, I guess from about that time on forward, I started really spending a lot of time learning about meditation because I felt that it was so impactful to what I was dealing with. Yeah. So over the years, as I, you know, have gotten into relationships, have gotten into different careers, breath work and meditation has really helped me cope, you know, with anxiety, learning how to deal with stress. Because a lot of us, we're not taught how to deal with stress. A lot of us household where you weren't taught how to, you know, deal with stress, how to deal with anxiety, just panic, even anger and frustration. A lot of us don't deal with that. A lot of us are not taught to how to deal with our emotions, our negative emotions. I know for me personally, culturally, you know, if I were to be frustrated and show the emotion of frustration about something, that was something in my household that didn't fly. So I did and how to deal with those emotions. So those are things that I had to learn. And so as we get into, you know, COVID-19 and all of that, before COVID had just started, I was a high school teacher. So I was a high school teacher for years, and it was a lot of stress coming out of this high school situation into this pandemic where everything went remote, went online. So I was used to being in the classroom every day. So pre-COVID, I had just a really strict regimen of what I would do on a daily basis. I would get up, I would journal, read some type of self-help material. I would say some affirmations, I would meditate, and then I would start my day. And that just really helped me navigate being a teacher and dealing with stress. But as we went into remote learning, which was a total different beast, and trying to teach kids from an online setting, and kids who I was teaching in a very underdeserved school. So there were lots of kids there that didn't have Wi-Fi. They didn't have access to be in class. So I started to be impacted just with the job and just my own personal life being in, you know, and remote learning and just trying to navigate all of this. So I started to see that even the mental health regimen, the self-care regimen that I had set up for myself was starting to fail. I needed something new, something that was going to work. And so as we got through COVID, I myself started to deal with depression. Like you said, it felt like a vacation at the beginning, right? A lot of us were thinking that this was going to be short-lived. Then we got into 3, 4, 5 months down the road, and we started to understand that this wasn't going to be something that was short-lived. This was actually going to be a change in the way that we've been doing things. And so for me, I needed to kind of change my self-care regimen. Now the things that I was doing, they weren't as impactful because everything about my whole career had changed.
Yes.
And then I'm married. So being in my marriage, also someone who's being impacted by this, I was trying to figure out ways how we could stay healthy mentally as we're coming into this pandemic. So for me, that it meant going back to the drawing board, figuring out what was going to work for me because so much had changed with my everyday to day life. So now coming through that, so I had to change some things up in terms of my meditation, what I was doing on a daily basis. I had to start exercising. I wasn't exercising as much. I was doing yoga, and yoga has always been really beneficial in my life, but I needed to do a little bit more. Right. I needed to get out and see, you know, the sun, be in nature because I was inside so much. So I was having to change things that I was doing. So in doing that, thankfully I'm in a healthy space now, but in the midst of this, so many people have lost jobs, family members, And the mental health issues have skyrocketed. So there's so many people who are impacted. And so if you look at the statistics for 2019, so many people, especially Black and Brown people who were losing, who were very greatly impacted by COVID-19 and also losing their jobs in droves were and losing family members, they were very impacted. Mental health completely, you know, changed across the board. We saw a skyrocket. And so people are getting into yoga and meditation and looking for self-care regimens now because so much has changed. And so now as we're getting out and we're getting to this post-COVID, we're still, you know, trickling out of it. People are coming out and they really have been impacted and they're looking for things to do to kind of help them to get into a healthy mental state as they're going back into the workplace. As you're learning to, you know, deal with, you know, all these changes that occurred over the last year. So I know in terms of relationships, this is a great conversation because a lot of people, you have to understand so many relationships were impacted, especially if you had family members die. So we're talking about family relationships that have changed. We're talking about even love relationships that have changed because you've been in quarantine with someone and the dynamics of your relationship has changed. So how do you deal with that? Like, what kind of regimen do you need to be doing? So you bring up a great topic because it comes back to self-care, which is going to be one of the things that I'm going to talk about the most today, because self-care is going to be the thing that gets us back to these healthy spaces that we need to be in.
Amazing. Amazing. You know, it's so funny you said that because I was thinking about, even as you were talking about the breathing exercises that you use, I referenced a scene. I don't know if you were a big soul food fan. I was a big soul food fan from Soul Food, you know, Soul Food with Stars. And I remember one scene with Terry, one of the sisters, where she was the lawyer in the family and she literally could not breathe. Like she was having a panic attack. And many times, especially like your bio says, in underserved communities, we have these situations that arise and we don't know. We don't know how to define it. We don't know what's going on with our bodies or the state of our wellness. And, you know, and that was my first time even knowing what a panic attack looks like. Yeah. And if I might be, because a part of this podcast is really about being authentic. So if I might, may, I've never really shared this with anyone, but I recall, like, I don't know if it was a year ago, but I recall there was a time in my life that I would, and maybe you can even help me with this, that I would wake up like abruptly, like literally KJ, I would wake up screaming, like out of my sleep. I might be like doze off or whatever. And out of my sleep, I would make up screaming, like going crazy. And it would happen so sporadically, but it happened in a way that I recall those moments. And I researched, I did kind of like my little research, you know, I did a little Google, you know, Google, right. Like, you know, what is that? So what do you think those episodes were?
I think it's anxiety, it's panic. And usually it's, so it can happen in a number of different ways. You know, anxiety and panic shows up differently for all of us.
Yes.
But you know, that can show up in not being able to sleep properly, having a disturbance in your sleep, having so much anxiety that it shows up as fear, or shows up as panic. It causes us to wake up, you know, abruptly or deal with panic where we're not able to have restful sleep. So those definitely can be that could come from panic and anxiety. So those could definitely be, you know, from things that you've dealt with. It could be from, you know, being in a stressful career. It could be from dealing with traumatic experiences. It could be dealing with, you know, just being in a bad space mentally and overthinking things. I tend to be an overthinker. And so maybe you dealt with something instead of allowing it to, or to allow yourself to be able to move through it. A lot of us dwell on things that we've dealt with, and that can, you know, cause these type of disturbances that we're waking up. And, you know, and I always tell people, you know, I do this, I've done this work for a little bit in terms of meditation and teaching people how to meditate and teaching coping mechanism, but I'm definitely not a mental health expert. So I think that is a really important thing too, is to use the tools and resources that are out there. If you cannot afford to see an expert or mental health specialist, there are tons of books and education and ways to educate yourself on what's happening. The information is there. It's just a matter of going and researching that information and looking up ways and tools in order to, you know, deal with the things that we're dealing with. But it's important to do the work, right? You're not going to get through to a healthier space unless you're doing the work.
Absolutely. You said it best. We have to do the work. I definitely recall that it has, though the issues have come kind of subside. I haven't experienced those in a while. So I know it's probably, it definitely is changing my mindset because I looked into it and it did say that it has to do with a lot of like career change, abrupt issues, adversities. So definitely, I'm so happy to say that it definitely has stopped because it was so scary. I was so afraid. And you know, the thing with mental health, it's not something you can diagnose. It's not something that you can take medication for. You know what I'm saying? Because it's like autism. It's on a spectrum. And like you said, it shows up differently for everyone, you know, and we are living in such a stressful society as is that we all have some type of mental stuff that we're working through. You know, and so what I wanted to ask you in terms of what you do when you're working with clients, what are some techniques that, you know, that we can use? And before you even say that, I just want to premise by saying this. I am so happy we are having this conversation because I really hope that this episode really can touch and it can reach who it needs to reach. And this is part of the reason why I really wanted us to have this conversation today, which, you know, I'm in New York City. Before I left out my house, I always have my regimen, turn on the news, listen to the news before I head out. And today, a story really touched me. A young lady, KJ, 24 years of age, 24, just had a baby a month ago. I don't know what, we all don't know what, even a neighbor's, they don't even know. She literally threw her baby outside the window. She threw her 1 month old baby outside the window and her toddler age child. And then she proceeds to throw herself out that same window. So I don't even want to get emotional because these topics are so needed, especially in our community. And like your bio says, underdeserved, because we know that there's something mental going on. So what are some techniques that you can leave for our viewer? Like you just said, who may not have money, who may not be able to, you know, go pay for a therapist, right? What are some techniques that we all can use to aid in our mental journey?
Okay. So a couple things. So, you know, stories like this, you know, these impact us, right? These are things that, you know, that women, that people are going through, and especially Black women. And I think it's really important to note that sometimes we need to make sure that we are talking to the proper, you know, experts, people who can help us with these things, because, you know, there are holistic ways of doing things. And then sometimes we do have to depend on, you know, the use of medication to get us into, you know, really healthy places. But I think that one thing that I teach meditation and yoga, and I tell people that I think that it is one of the most impactful tools in dealing with our mental health. It slows down this overthinking. It gets us to a space where we're able to better cope with the things that we are going through on a daily basis. But I do realize that for some people, you know, time is of the essence, that time may be an issue. Some people may not have the necessary time that it takes to sit down and meditate. But I tell people, you have to figure out what's going to work best for you. But one thing that I have always, that I do want to share here, that I have always thought to be so to my life, especially when I was dealing with deep depression and anxiety, is breath work. So taking deep breaths. I think a lot of us don't understand the healing power of the breath, right? When you're dealing with stress and anxiety, when you're dealing with depression, a lot of times the breathing pattern, the way that you're breathing, is very much so impacted. When you're dealing with anxiety, there's this ability sometimes that we get ourselves to this space where we're overthinking things and you have no consciousness of the breath. And a lot of times that may be us holding the breath or breathing pretty quickly, especially when you're dealing with panic, because you're in this flight or fight mode. So you're over breathing, you're taking in too much oxygen. And then when you are in panic and anxiety, a lot of times when you're overthinking things, you have a tendency to hold the breath. So yeah. I think a really good way to, help us get through some of these tough times is by bringing our awareness, bringing our attention to the breath, taking a deep breath, a full breath through the nose, expanding the belly, pushing that belly out, we're filling the lungs out, and then letting that air out through the nose as slow as you can, right? Because you want to inhale the air, inhale oxygen, and then you want to release it really slowly. You're trying to slow the breath. It's a good way of getting rid of that anxiety, getting back to a calm and peaceful place. So I tell people, take slow, deep breath. It counts to four in your head as you're inhaling, then exhale for six if you can, just slow as you can. And just do that over and over, at least for a minute. Try for 1 minute where you're just inhaling slowly for four and then exhaling slowly for six. In and out the nose, just inhaling and exhaling, and you get yourself back to this peaceful and this calm space. So the breath is going to be one of our most powerful tools where we don't have to reach out to anybody. We can just utilize the breath to get back to this centeredness, this space of calmness, this space of peacefulness. So the breath is going to be a good tool. People have used breath work to heal cancer, to get rid of altogether. That's how powerful the breath is. So if you don't have access to anything else, and sometimes I understand the need to need something else, to need help. And there are resources out there that you can, look to, and definitely check out my page. I will put as many resources up as I can, especially if you're dealing with anything like suicide or anything, you're having feelings of suicide or anything like that. There are resources out there that will help. But if we just want to just get back to a moment of calmness or peace, use the breath. Inhale for four, exhale for five. Maybe you're not able to inhale that deeply yet. That's okay. Inhale for one or two. Take a deep breath and just let that deep breath out as slow as you possibly can. Slow the breath so you can get back to this space of calmness, the peace, centeredness, this space where you're able to kind of clear your head for a moment before you proceed forward. Because I understand that a lot of us, we don't know how to deal with stress and anxiety. We're not coming from households about that. So you have to figure out what's going to work for you. And I say this to people over and over, just Google whatever it is you're feeling. There are resources out there that's going to help you through it. There are people out there who have gone through the same thing. There are people who are writing books about whatever it is that you're dealing with. You can go to the library and check out a book for free. You don't have to buy it. And just so you're able to navigate to a healthier space until you're able to maybe seek out an expert or just another resource to help you through.
Absolutely. And what about some ecosystems? Are there communities that folks can go to, any that you know off the top of your head people can really plug in with?
Oh, of course. So there's tons. So if you're on social media, that's the best way to find out these ecosystems, these people that are doing this necessary work, right? So if you're able to go to Instagram, look up something. There's one lady, Yoga and Mahogany. She's a Black yogi, and I love her. I follow her. But she's talking about things like racism in yoga and how racial trauma impacts a lot of us. A lot of us that are living in these underserved communities, we're seeing a lot of things that are impacted, that impact us, that have to do with racism. So there are people out there that are talking about those things and sharing resources. I know on her page, she's showing all types of yoga movements and postures that impact certain things that can be helpful. Maybe you're just dealing with anxiety and stress. There are people on social media that can provide ecosystems to the very cities that you're living in. So you're just going to have to Google, search out some of these people. There are free resources. I know here in Atlanta, they hold different things like yoga in the park, where it's just free. You can just go to the park and learn yoga and meditation. So that's happening all of the summer. If you Google yoga in the park, so many things will come up for Atlanta and for the Georgia area. So just look for resources in your city. They're out there. So I'm only really familiar with the ones here in Atlanta, but I know that if you just look for yoga in the park, they're throwing block parties. They're doing things where they're teaching these techniques where you can come together and practice yoga with other yogis that are willing to teach you, how to do this basic yoga, which can be so impactful to your mental health.
Absolutely. That's amazing. Those are amazing tips. And those are like readily available tips that you can access. You spoke earlier about, in terms of the quarantine, as it pertains to like being in a relationship, if you're married mm-hmm. or, you know, if you have a partner, whatever. What are some, you know, suggestions would you say, even as people are going through those type of tense relationship, like what are some suggestions would you say that people can use in terms of, again, mental wellness, keeping in that same vein?
Of course. So one thing that I think is really beneficial is learning how to do self-care routines together. So it's necessary for you to figure out what self-care routines are going to be impactful to you, right? Because your mental health is going to be such a huge part of the relationship that you're in. It's necessary for you to be in a good space. But here's the thing, it's okay not to be in a good space, because it's unrealistic to think that we're always going to be in this great space, right?
Yes.
But you just need to know the necessary self-care routines is going to get you back up to back to par, like back to feeling good. And what's been very beneficial in my own relationship is doing these self-care regimens together. So maybe taking 5-minute meditations together. So usually I will sit in silent meditation by myself for about 30 minutes, but I think that it's been very impactful to my relationship to also sit in meditation with my spouse. Talk about the things that you're feeling, share what's happening with you in terms of your mental health with your partner. You want to get to a level where you're comfortable enough to share the thing that you're feeling, the thing that you're experiencing, because you don't want to suffer in silence and your partner or your spouse not know what's happening. So I think a good way to make sure that you're doing healthy things inside of the relationship is to share what's happening in terms of your own mental health. And also do a check-in with your partner. Check on their mental health. Ask how they're doing today. Ask, you know, how are you feeling? I know that we've been stuck in this quarantine. We've been without work. There's so many things that's happened and changed in the course of our own career. Talk about it. Share what's happening in your relationship. Talk about what's happening in terms of your mental health. Talk about what's happening in your job, in your workspace, how you're feeling about working from home. Any changes that you're having, share that with your partner, share that with your spouse, because that's going to be so important, not only to their mental health, but to your mental health. Do self-care regimens together. Read a book together, maybe a book on relationships. Maybe you both are dealing with a level of stress. Read a book on stress. Talk about the things that are going to be impactful that you can do together, because there's no better way than to do a self-care regimen with your partner if you're in a relationship. That's a beautiful way to kind of build a deeper connection, especially if you're having, you know, some difficulties there. And look, we all go through, especially if you're married. I'm married. Marriage isn't perfect. You're going to have to learn how to, you know, get through difficult times together. And a lot of times that could be dealing with those difficulties together, talking about it, being open and honest, you know, honest about what you're feeling. Maybe we've spent too much time together because we're in here in quarantine, we're locked together. Maybe we need a little bit of alone time. So figure out ways that you can do that. Now that we're coming out of quarantine, so maybe you're able to, you know, have a little bit of distance now, but just make sure that you're doing the necessary self-care routines together and by yourself to make sure that you're in a good and healthy space.
Oh my gosh, girl, we got to have you back on. I mean, this is perfect. Like, you were literally dropping gems. And I like that. You know, it's crazy. I never thought about that. That definitely, you know, connecting with your partner in a deeper way, that can really, that really amplifies everything. And that really shows genuine love. Like, you are able to, but I must say, it has to be a safe space. It has to be a safe space in order to connect on that deeper level and really get in tune with each other's feelings.
Right. Yeah. And if it's not a safe space, that's a great topic. That's something to talk about, that maybe I haven't felt that this is a safe space for me to verbalize how I'm feeling or what's happening. So maybe that's something you guys need to talk about. There are so many things out there in terms of resources, books, workbooks that you can work through together to kind of deal with those necessary difficult topics and things to talk about. So even if it's not a safe space, maybe you can verbalize that. Maybe that's something you guys can tackle and talk about, because it's a relationship. So you want to make sure that you're being just as honest and open as you can be, because honesty, trust are the things that's going to help us grow in this partnership. And if you don't have trust because you don't feel that the space is safe, that is something that you definitely can deal with. That's something that you can talk about. So maybe before we deal with the things that are happening, maybe we need to deal with the fact that it's not a safe space or hasn't been. Maybe we need to deal with the traumas that have caused us to get to this space, or the things that have caused us to get to this space where I feel that it's not a safe space. Or maybe I don't feel it's a safe space because I don't trust it from things that have happened in my past. Maybe it's a personal thing. So I think that when you're dealing with all of those types of things, you have to kind of be open and honest about that, because if it's not a safe space because it's something personal that you've dealt with, express that if you're able to. You know, let that be something that you talk about so you can better navigate these difficult waters sometimes that arise in relationships. Yeah.
And as you navigate it, you explore it, and you become a more wholesome human being, because you're, like you said, you're doing the work. And I think it's a beautiful thing when we are continually evolving. But like you said, having these conversations many years ago, we never used to be so open, you know, especially in communities of color, having conversations about feelings and how I'm being treated. Like we rug, especially in Black communities or households, you know. I'm Caribbean, so a lot of times, you know, issues, they just get swept. They get swept under the rug and they amplify and they manifest in so many different ways. And that's why me, and I think it is so imperative that we really break generational setbacks. I don't want to say curses, but generational setbacks. We have to be different from our ancestors. We have to have this communication. You know, Keja, as we close out, because we are speaking about relationship in terms of mental wellness, statistics have shown that through this quarantine, many friendships also have been challenged. So as we close, what would you say to anyone that's going through that transition where they have friends, they have really dear friends, but, you know, the issues of quarantine and isolation has really, you know, impacted their friendship? What would you say to someone that's going through that as well?
Of course. So just like any relationship, you have to feed any relationship that you're in, right? And sometimes in the midst of our friendship, we'll have friends that are really suffering or have really suffered, especially through this pandemic, especially if they've lost loved ones or lost jobs, or they just have gotten, you know, to the space where they too are dealing with their own mental health issues. I think a beautiful way to address difficulties that are coming up in friendships is also through honesty. But more than anything, invite your friend to this space that you're trying to get to. If I'm working on my mental health, I'm going to be very verbal about that. Or maybe I will choose to be very verbal about that with my friend, so they too can kind of really think about the things that I'm doing. So maybe it can motivate them to also start doing some of these self-care things to make sure we're in a healthy space. Because what I'm learning about relationships, period, is relationships are going to start with you, right? Because you're going to be one part of that relationship. And if you want that relationship to thrive, it's really important that you're doing the necessary work to make sure that you're in the healthiest space possible. And like I said, sometimes we're going to be in spaces where we just need a moment. We need a moment to kind of navigate through our own troubles or what it is that we're dealing with, then be verbal about that with your friend. You know, be verbal about you needing that time to step away from the friendship so you can better focus on yourself. Because when you're able to focus on yourself, you're able to come back to the friendship and be a really integral part of that relationship, right? A really beneficial part. Really, you're one half of that love. You're one half of the thing that's going to make that relationship work. So it's really important to make sure you're doing or taking the necessary steps to work on you so you can be really healthy in that friendship. So it can continue to flourish, right? So you can continue to grow old and have a lovely relationship. So it's just important to make sure that you're doing the necessary work. And that's just my best advice, because a lot of us, we tend to look at the other person, right? We tend to point out all of their flaws. All the things that they're doing wrong. But a lot of times those relationships are a reflection of us. So our friendship, our love relationship, oftentimes are a reflection of us. It's a mirror image of what we've been projecting, of what we, because like attracts like, whether you believe that or not. If you are a friend and you're putting out negative or toxic energy, or you're not being as a supportive friend, most of the time you're going to get that in return through the people that you're befriending. So if you're working on yourself and you're making sure that you're offering to the relationship what it is that you want to get back, most of the time the people that are not meant for our journey will just fall off by themselves. You won't have to shut anybody out of your life. But if you're adding to that beauty, if you're adding to that friendship, and you're doing the necessary work on yourself, then you're going to have those type of people. You're going to start to see those mirror images show up in your relationship. Maybe they'll choose to take some different make some changes to their own life. If not, then maybe they weren't meant for the journey. It's just for a short time. And so, and it always hurts when we lose friendships, right? right. We don't want to do that. But sometimes it's a necessary thing to do when we're growing, when we're moving from one space in our life to the other. So just make sure that you're doing all the necessary work to make sure you're in a healthy space. And 9 times out of 10, your friendships will reflect that as well.
Oh my gosh, you couldn't say it better. Oh my gosh, KJ, thank you so much for your authenticity. Thank you, girl. I feel like you're speaking to my soul. You're speaking into my soul.
Thank you for having me.
Yes, thank you. And thank you so much for, I know you're super busy. And I just want to thank you so much publicly for availing yourself to this conversation. And really, it's a pleasure. And I definitely want to bring you back. But thank you for joining us today. So you guys, please follow KJ online on IG, KJ Landers. KJ, you do something that I really like on IG. I think you do like a meditation Monday.
So I do a motivation Monday. So I'll get a little motivation on Mondays. I just give a little bit of life advice or just things that have worked for me personally that I think are very beneficial. And in doing that, I think that it adds a little bit more of joy to your life. Or I try to give a little bit of tidbit of something that's been very impactful in terms of my own mental health that helps me navigate when I'm having a tough day or when I just need a little bit of a push. So yeah, Mondays, I'll usually put them on my story. So definitely check it out.
Definitely. Well, you know, we will. So once again, guys, thank you so much for tuning in today. Thank you to all my guests. Thank you, KJ. All my guests, this month has been phenomenal. If you like this episode, please like it, please share it, and definitely follow us online. KJ, it's a pleasure. Be well. Thank you so much. Be safe.
Thank you. Bye.
Bye, guys. Night.